Hello, this is Kelly Reed, pastor of Pleasant Grove Baptist Church here in Newport, Tennessee. Thanks for joining me today as we continue to look into the Word of God and pursue answers to questions of faith and life. Let me just take this time to invite you to visit our fellowship, Pleasant Grove Baptist Church. We're just 5 miles east of Newport off of I-40 and the 440 exit. Our Sunday morning services start at 10:45. We'd love to have you come by for a visit. If you do want to discover more about us, please go to our website, www.pleasantgrovenewport.com. Now, last time, before we got into the holiday season with Hanukkah and Christmas, we were in the book of Acts. Paul was talking with the Ephesian elders as he was on his way back to Jerusalem, and it was highlighting how important the feasts, the biblical feasts, were still in the life of the apostles and the early church, because he was trying to get back there before Pentecost or Shavuot, the Feast of Weeks. He reminded them on his way as he was trying to hurry through about his ministry and his goals. Paul, things that he taught were important. He was wanting to teach the things that were profitable: repentance towards God, faith in Jesus the Messiah. You look at the things that Paul was prizing, the idea of finishing his course in ministry and testifying to the gospel of God's grace. But you also look at what Paul expected. He expected chains and afflictions that awaited him in Jerusalem. He received many warnings along the way about what was going to happen, but those warnings did not stop him from going, in the same way that they didn't stop Jesus from going to Jerusalem, even though he knew what was going to happen to him there. But what kind of reception do you think he would get when he got there, from the church? I mean, there was some question about how he was going to be received. In Acts chapter 21, verse 17, says, when he reached Jerusalem, the brothers welcomed us gladly. Verse 18, the following day, Paul went in with us to James, and all the elders were present. And after greeting them, he related in detail what God did among the Gentiles through his ministry. And this is the important part in verse 20. It's so important that we keep this in mind. He says, when they, James and the other apostles and elders, when they heard it, they glorified God. And so what we see there in that passage, the church in Jerusalem, including James, the brother of Jesus, who is now one of the leaders in the church and who wrote the book of James. His real name is Jacob, by the way. After hearing how things went, they were thrilled and excited. And they never could have expected that so many Gentiles would have believed in the Jewish Messiah. So remember, in the early days of the church, the issue was, could the Gentiles be saved? And if so, how much of their old life did they have to leave behind, and how much did they have to adopt a biblical lifestyle? So how would these Gentiles know how to live in their new faith? What would they have to change? What would they have to know? What could they keep from their old life, and what did they have to leave behind? That was one of the pressing questions that they were trying to answer in several of the books, including Romans and Galatians and Acts. Can they keep whatever they want, or does the Word of God decide their lives, their new lives in Christ? See, a brand new believer, whether they are pagan or Jewish, is going to have to relearn how to live and how to walk with God, not based on religion, not based upon doing things to try to please God, not based on earning one's salvation or establishing one's own righteousness or even the sacrifices like a Jewish person, nor through idolatry like a pagan, trying to appease the God's anger, or through their pagan sacrifices or sexuality like the Gentiles would. But both sides, they're still going to have to relearn how to live. And that's where the Word of God comes in. That's where it's so important for us, at the beginning of our new calendar year in America here, is where does the Word of God fit in our lives? And again, remember back when this was going on, the only Word of God that they had access to was what we would call the Old Testament, the Torah, the prophets, and the writings. How much of a greater blessing are we in because we have the complete testimony of the Old Testament scriptures that pointed forward to Jesus, and then we have the Brit Hadashah, the New Testament, that tells us about the life and ministry of Jesus and the early church. How much more do we have, and how fewer excuses do we have? Because every one of us has the Bible available to us all the time. See, we learn how we should live, how we should act, what is right and what is wrong for the believer from the Word of God. It's not arbitrary. It's not just anyone's opinion. It's what is in the Word. And if we say we believe the Word of God, then we have to not just be hearers of the Word, but doers also. Our lives must change and conform to it. And as you are going through in the coming year, as you're starting out, I pray that your life, that you would choose to settle this issue, that you would be a doer of the Word, that you would resolve to be a doer of the Word of God, that you would change your life to the Word of God, that you would conform your life to the Word of God and not to your opinion, popular opinion, the culture's opinion, but to what does the Word of God say. Because see, the Word of God lets us know what sin is. Sin is missing the mark. And according to 1 John 3, verse 4, it says, everyone who commits sin also breaks the law. Sin is the breaking of the law, breaking of the Torah, the commands, the instructions, the directions from God. And if you want to know what sin is, we need to look at what the Word says. But the Word of God not only tells us what is wrong and what not to do, the Word of God gives us instructions on what to do, the right way to live. You know, the Torah, the instructions from God's Word, is how we hit the mark in our walk with God. You know, if sin is to miss the mark, the instructions, the Torah from God, is how to hit the mark in our walk. That's the process of sanctification. You know, the Word of God, you know, which is the Torah, which is the law, shows us how we are to live and walk in a way that is pleasing to God. Because we know, or you should know, that the Word of God is trustworthy. The Word of God is even beautiful. It's true. It lasts forever. And it's not done away with. You know, some would say that Paul was in conflict with this idea, that the instructions in the law has nothing to contribute to our lives. But Paul teaches clearly, you know, that we are all sinners and all have fallen short. We've all broken the law, and we cannot earn our salvation by trying to keep it. But does that mean we just throw it all out? Does that mean God's grace negates any benefit of God's law and telling us how to live? There are curses for disobeying the law. And that's, you know, the death and the punishment. And that's what was done away with in the sacrifice of Jesus. But, you know, there are blessings for keeping the law. Again, not to earn your salvation, but in doing what is right and what pleases God. It's not against grace to obey God. You know, what did the early church do? Look in Acts chapter 21, verse 20. And, you know, this is after they had said that they were excited about what was going on in Paul's ministry to the Gentiles. Acts 21, verse 20 goes on to say, and he said, you see, brother, how many thousands of Jews there are who have also believed. So he's saying that I'm glad to hear that so many Gentiles are believing, but look at how many Jews are also believing. But look at what he says next. He says, and they are all zealous for the law. They have believed in Messiah. They have believed in Jesus, and they are still zealous for the law. This is years after the resurrection. See, not only have many Gentiles believed, but so have many Jews, and they are still zealous for the law, for the Torah, for the instructions of God's Word. And see, we look at these, that statement like that, and we think that those have to be mutually exclusive, that they can't be a believer and be zealous for the law. We think it's a bad thing. But obviously, the apostles and the early church did not think that was inconsistent, did not think that was contradictory, did not think that was a problem at all. But wait, didn't Jesus negate the law? No, he did not. In fact, he never broke the law, for if he broke the law, he would become a sinner, because sin is the breaking of the law. Instead, Jesus says that not a jot or a tittle, not the smallest stroke of a pen, will pass away until everything comes to fulfillment. He says he came to fulfill it and essentially uphold it, is another way of translating it. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, he says, Don't assume that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill or uphold. For I assure you, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter or one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all things are accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commands and teaches people to do so will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. That's a powerful statement. Not only should you not break these commands, but you shouldn't teach other people that it's okay to break the commands either. And if you do, you'll be called least in the kingdom of heaven. Instead, but whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Now, if Jesus said that, would it make sense that Jesus would teach people to negate or break the law? Really? Because, see, for him to do so, by his own words, would make him least in the kingdom of heaven. See, when Jesus disputed with the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, he wasn't doing so over the law itself. He was always referring back to what does the law say or the spirit of the law. He disputed over the tradition of the elders, those additional extra-biblical teachings that had built up over the years, the commentary, the legal precedent or opinion, much found in the Talmud or the Mishnah or some other commentaries. Jesus' problem was that they gave those traditions equal weight and authority with what the Word of God actually says, and Jesus called them out for it. Now, how many of you have commentaries in your book collection, or you know your pastor does? How many, you know, if you receive Sunday school material? I know in Southern Baptist Life we get a lot of the Herschel Hobbs commentary. And have you ever disagreed with the commentary? I hope so. I mean, you should from time to time, because the commentaries are just what people have to say about it. Guys like Herschel Hobbs, that was just a man. But what would you say to me if I came up, or if your pastor came up to the pulpit and began teaching from the commentary and holding what it said to be equal to what Scripture says? Even if you look at it and say, that's not right. See, if I started saying that you had to obey the commentary or obey Hobbs just as much as you would the Scriptures themselves, I hope you would understand that that would be wrong. You would be right to reject that. See, that's different from saying that you should obey the Scriptures. It's different from when you come to a passage of Scripture that you don't like or don't understand or you disagree with it. You can disagree with a commentary and be okay, but can you disregard the Scripture like you would a commentary? No, we cannot. We cannot just write off Scripture as if it was just someone's opinion, like whether chocolate is better than vanilla, because the Scripture is inspired from God. All Scripture is inspired from God and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. See, the Holy Spirit is the source, not just opinion. We don't get to judge Scripture. We don't get to add to Scripture. We don't get to subtract to Scripture just because we want to, or because times have changed, or we've become more civilized, or it's not popular. We obey it. We don't change it. See, that's the issue that Jesus actually had. The rabbis, the commentators, were adding and subtracting just from Scripture based on this tradition of the elders and the teachings as if they had equal authority. An example would be Mark chapter 7, verse 1, where he says, "The Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around him. And they observed that some of Jesus' disciples, they were eating their bread with unclean, that is, unwashed hands." Verse 3 says, "For the Pharisees, in fact all the Jews, will not eat unless they wash their hands ritually, keeping the tradition of the elders." There's that statement. "And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they have washed. And there are many other customs they have received and keep, like the washing of cups, jugs, copper utensils, and dining couches." Then the Pharisees and the scribes asked Jesus, "Why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders, instead of eating bread with ritually unclean hands?" Is washing your hands bad? No, not really. I mean, washing your dishes, making sure they're clean, not contaminating your food, of course that's not bad. Otherwise, Jesus would be seem to be advocating every child's dream, every person who ever worked in a restaurant kitchen's desire that they don't need to wash their hands or they don't need to wash their dishes. That's clearly not what Jesus is talking about. Cleanliness is not really the issue. Truth be told, the washing they were referring to didn't really even include enough water to get the whole plate or the whole hands wet. It wasn't about being clean of dirt and grime, but rather in a ceremonial, ritualistic sense. I must do this in order to be right before God. And it was doing the bare minimum, the very least amount to get by, or the least amount to qualify. The word is actually the word common. It's not the word clean. It's what makes a person unusable for God's purposes. So think about it like this. How many of you pray before you eat? Do you ever feel bad if you forget to do so, if you forget to pray, and then you stop all of a sudden with the food still in your mouth, you say a quick one like, thank you, Lord, for this food, amen. Did the food suddenly become more spiritual or better for you? Is your salvation dependent upon saying this prayer before you eat it? Become common like an unbeliever or unusable to God if you forget to pray before your food. See, these Pharisees were essentially saying, yes, you have to do that, otherwise God is going to reject you. They were focusing on the small matter of tradition, not the actual law of God, and making it a salvific type of issue. And that's not to downplay saying that you shouldn't pray before you eat. I think you should. But sometimes we treat it and act it in like much like the Pharisees did with the washing of the hands. See, instead of addressing the small matter, Jesus instead showed them their hypocrisy, that they weren't really interested in obeying God, obeying the law at all. Because if they could find a way around it, if the Pharisees could find a way around the word of God, they would. Even something as basic as one of the top 10, the 10 commandments of honoring and caring for your parents, they would try to find some way to get around doing that. Verse 6, he says, he answered them. Isaiah prophesied, this is Mark chapter 7. Isaiah prophesied correctly about you hypocrites, as it is written, these people, they honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. They worship me in vain, teaching as doctrines the commands of men, disregarding the command of God. See the breakdown that he's making there? They're making the commands of men and the commands of God equal, and they're not. He also said to them, you completely invalidate God's command in order to maintain your tradition. Verse 10 says, for Moses said, honor your father and mother, and whoever speaks evil of father and mother must be put to death. But you say, if a man tells his father or mother, you know, whatever benefit you might have received from me is korban. Now that is, it's a gift committed to the temple. And verse 12 says, you no longer let him do anything for his father or mother. By doing so, verse 13 says, you're revoking God's word by your tradition that you've handed down, and you do many other similar things. That's Jesus' assessment. Jesus was calling them out for adding or subtracting from the word by their tradition. The tradition of the elders was used as a means of finding loopholes to do from what the word actually said. That's the same kind of thing that Jesus would, that's what he would conflict with. And the same for us. Any of our reasoning, any of the excusing that we can come up with to get around what the Word of God says, Jesus rejects that and he points you back to the Word. See, in today's world, this is what our world needs more of, is pointing back to the Word of God. And I hope that you'll do that in this year ahead. In today's world, we see our people trying to get around issues of marriage, of sexuality, of idolatry, of changing what is evil into good and what is good into evil. See, all of Jesus' life and teachings were consistent with what the Word of God says. To negate it, to contradict it, would not be teaching or speaking the words of his father. It would, in fact, nullify his position as the Messiah for him to do so. And that's important for us to remember. If Jesus was contradicting the word, the Torah, the law, then he would not be fit to be the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. But everything that he says is consistent with what his father has said. Back in the book of Acts, chapter 20, he said, you know, you see, brothers, how many thousands of Jews there are who have believed, and they are all zealous for the law. That same statement could be said about Jesus himself. He was a man who was sinless, and he was still zealous for the law. So in Jerusalem, in the early church, it was not incompatible with faith in Christ to still be zealous for the law and for the Torah. And to suggest otherwise is to say that James and the other apostles and leaders were teaching wrong things, practicing their faith incorrectly. They did not see an inconsistency with saved by grace through faith and being zealous for the Torah, for the law. That's why James says to be doers of the words and not just hearers only. So why he could say faith without works, without living by the Torah, the law, the word of God, he says that's dead. See, the law has a bad connotation to us. It is really the instructions on how to live and walk with God. It doesn't have the negativity that we sometimes associate with it. You know, Jesus did not throw it out, nor could he. Because, and this is one thing that many Jewish people know, if they actually believe their scriptures, that anyone who advocates going after any other gods, anyone who advocates disregarding or writing off the Torah, even if their ministry is accompanied by signs and wonders, Jewish people who know the scriptures know that such a person is a false teacher. That's Deuteronomy chapter 13, verse 1. If a prophet or someone who has dreams arises among you and proclaims a sign or wonder to you, and that sign or wonder he's promised you comes about, but he says, let us follow other gods, which you've not known, or let us worship them, do not listen to that prophet's word or to that dreamer, for the Lord your God is testing you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. You must follow the Lord your God and fear him. You must keep his commands and listen to his voice. You must worship him and remain faithful to him. See, we all know that that could not be talking about Jesus. Because, again, he would be disqualified if it was. So we have to know that Jesus was one who performed many signs and wonders, but he never would have said, let us follow after other gods. He would have never said, let us disregard the word or the law of God. Well, we should know, you should know, that the Antichrist is someone who is going to do this. His ministry is going to be accompanied by signs and wonders. The Antichrist is, and some say, even bringing someone back from the dead, maybe even himself. He will lead the whole world away from God to other gods, deceiving, if possible, even the elect. And he is described as a man of lawlessness. Daniel chapter 7, verse 25 says, he will speak words against the Most High and oppress the holy ones of the Most High. He will intend to change the religious festivals, the feast days, and the laws, the law of God. And the holy ones will be handed over to him for a time, times, and half a time. So the Antichrist is the one who's going to be fulfilling this passage of Scripture. And this is exactly what is people often say about Jesus, about the new church, and about the Apostle Paul. Because an accusation has been following Paul around, a rumor against him that must be dealt with. And what's the rumor? Well, the rumor is that he is changing the times and the laws. Look at verse 21 of Acts chapter 21 says, but they have been told, this is James speaking, he's talking about the rumor. He says, they have been told about you, that you teach all the Jews who are among the Gentiles to abandon Moses, by telling them not to circumcise their children or to walk in our customs. So what is to be done? They will certainly hear that you have come. So this is the dilemma. Can they be zealous for the law and still be a believer? Or is this rumor true, Paul, that you've been telling you can throw the law and all that stuff away? See, James and the church in Jerusalem had heard the reports about Paul, as people came to Jerusalem for the annual pilgrimages, that he was saying, throw it out. And they have questions about it. Even Peter admits that some of Paul's writings and some of his teachings were hard to understand and that unstable people distort them. But they were suggesting something else, that Paul was preaching against the word of God and that the Jews had to stop living according to the word's prescriptions. So were these true or were they false accusations? Was Paul really changing the law? And the answer is no, they were false charges. He didn't tell anyone that the word had nothing to contribute to their lives. No one was free to be an idolater. No one was free to be an adulterer or a liar. No one was free to go on with life just as it was before coming to Jesus. Paul taught that Gentiles didn't have to be circumcised to be saved. Now, he didn't teach anybody to quit the practice entirely. If Paul agreed with how the rumor characterized what he said and taught, then he would have said so. Because Paul he's not one to shy away from a tough issue or a subject. So when Peter was in the wrong, Paul spoke up. Again, the rumors were not true. Paul was not teaching those things. You can be zealous for the law and still rest in the grace of God. And if Paul disagreed, he would have never agreed to what the proposal that came next. Verse 23 says, therefore do what we tell you. We have four men who have obligated themselves with a vow. Again, a vow, that's all Old Testament descriptions and law. He says, take these men, purify yourself along with them, and pay for them to get their heads shaved. Then everyone will know that what they were told about you amounts to nothing, but that you yourself are also careful about observing the law. With regard to the Gentiles who have believed, we have written a letter containing our decision that they should keep themselves from food sacrificed to idols, from blood, from what is strangled, and from sexual immorality. And all of those issues were basics, the first starting point in the changed life of a new believer. But they were all consistent with the Torah. He says, we know Paul agreed because we see that he was willing to do everything they suggested because he agreed that the rumors were false. Verse 26 goes on to say, "The next day Paul took the man, having purified himself along with them, and entered the temple, announcing the completion of the purification days when the offering for each of them would be made." See, Paul, he didn't want the rumor to define him. He didn't want the name of Jesus to lose glory and attention because of falsehood. So he listened to the counsel of James and the other leaders and submitted to their suggestions, submitted to a visible demonstration to the Word of God, not to be saved, not to earn God's favor, but because the alternative was hurting the witness of Christ. The lie, the falsehood, was causing trouble. Now, what does that say to us? It means that our traditions, our customs, even the things that we like to do, must be subjected to the Word of God and not the other way around. His Word is the lamp unto our feet and a light to our path. He sanctifies us. He makes us holy by His Word. And this coming year needs to be reflective of that in your life. And we must carefully guard our actions, our teachings, and compare them to the Word of God, not to our preferences, not what our culture accepts as normal. We must be willing to stand on the foundation of the Word of God, not in judgment over the Word, not trying to find ways around it, saying how it doesn't apply to us. We need to take Scripture more seriously, not less. We need to stand apart from the culture more, not blend in more. And we have to realize that the cause of Christ is more important than our own lives and our own comfort. And if there are parts of our life that hinder that cause, we must seek to remedy them, to change them, to remove them. To say that Paul taught that the law did not apply to us is to say that his accusers were correct. And I do not accept that. They were not correct. If we want to know how to live, we must let the Word change our lives. And we must submit ourselves to it. I pray that we would be willing to do that more and more. Father, I pray that you would be at work in us, and that your Word would truly change us. Amen. Well, I do thank you for your time today. I pray that you've been blessed by God's Word, and that you'll have a great understanding of what it means to live in the Word, and be even zealous for the Word. If you do have any questions about faith in Christ, about the Bible, about Pleasant Grove Baptist Church, please contact me by email. It's Pastor Kelly. It's Kelly with a Y. PastorKelly@PleasantGroveNewport.com or at our website, www.PleasantGroveNewport.com. You'll find a map and directions as well as our service times. May God bless you, and may He continue to speak to you this year. In Jesus' name, amen. When he